shoot. Fires from the top of the key and takes it home. The Liberty take a 2-point lead.
Welcome to Liberty FM, the podcast dedicated to all things New York Liberty. I'm Francois, and I'm joined by my co-host and wife, Felicia. We're excited to jump into this next episode talking about Game 3 win for the Liberty, 81-65 over the Connecticut Sun. So, Felicia, how are we feeling about this weekend's win?
We're feeling good. We're definitely feeling good. Those ladies grind out this last win. The first half wasn't great, but they picked it up in the second half. They made the adjustments, and they got a win. So, I'm happy.
So let's dive into the first half, which the Connecticut Sun won 38-32. The biggest thing in the first half was definitely the turnovers for the Liberty, which had 8 turnovers to 4, and also a lack of three-pointers. The Connecticut Sun scored 6 three-pointers versus 1 for the New York Liberty. Felicia, what did you make of that first half?
Tiffany Hayes was a problem, definitely, for them. I think the transition defense was also a problem. They started pretty shaky, I think, the first half. You can tell they're a bit all over the place. Connecticut had a plan, and they executed. Miraculously, though, I would say the Liberty stayed in the game. I mean, I think they only were up by, 6 points by the end of the first half? So.
Yeah.
You know, it was still good. They still kept it close, I think, by penetrating in the paint. So that really helped them. I think Jonquil Jones, she's getting her legs under her, but you can tell that it's a bit difficult for her. And then she got into early foul trouble, too. But she's a beast in the paint, as is Sabally when she came in. So I think all in all, even though they didn't execute like they wanted to, they kept it close, surprisingly.
Well, that's the thing with the New York Liberty. They have a lot of talent on their roster, but you know, just putting talent on the floor doesn't mean that it's gonna click automatically. And I think it was beneficial for them to have the full week to train. They didn't have any game prior to that, since the second game. So I think it was good for them to have that time training, getting things figured out, try to learn how to play together, especially on offense. But it's gonna take some time. But with the talent that we have on the team, we can make any team pay at any given time. We saw with Stephanie Dawson at the post, she had a couple of assists to guards cutting to the basket. And as you also mentioned, Sabally, that we will mention later on the podcast. So, you know, struggling first half, but we knew that second half they were gonna bring something different. So. What about that second half, which was a complete shift compared to the first half? What did you make of it, Felicia?
Yeah, the second half, they picked it up, you know, especially that third quarter. You know, Breonna Stewart definitely turned it up. Vandersloot, I mean, everyone came in and turned it up. I think it was a complete switch is what they needed. Vandersloot, the general, she took over. It was important for that to happen because I think it got everybody going. Once Vandersloot got going and really pushed the pace, everyone started to pick up. And, you know, I think Vandersloot and Stewart made them pay. With Connecticut double-teaming Stewie all the time, it left room for Sabrina to operate and get her shots. And so it was a great second half, I think.
Yes, definitely. I think, like, the second half was completely different in terms of intensity, whether on defense and offense. And it all started with Courtney Vandersloot. And there was a tweet from Kalia Copper, a former teammate from the Chicago Sky, that really made me laugh when she said that somebody tell the New York Liberty they are not allowed to call Sloot the general without my permission. And the general is definitely the term that comes to mind with that player. She was the drive of the team, whether defensively, she had quite a few steals, offensively as well, she upped the tempo very well, and distributing to the perfection. That was definitely the player that got my attention. And when you look at the stats, 18 points, 10 assists, and 6 rebounds, she was really, really the difference maker, don't you think?
Yeah, definitely. I think coming into the second half, you know, they definitely made the necessary changes. I think with Sloot and Stewart, they just took over. And between Kayla Thornton, Ionescu, Laney, they just contributed, and it gave them a shot at really putting this game away, which they did.
Yeah, and now let's talk about Brianna Stewart. Obviously, second game, 45 points, a franchise record. You know, obviously, she's not going to have a performance like this every game. And the focus on the Connecticut Sun was definitely to try to slow her down in the first half. We saw a lot of double teaming, a lot of pressure. She couldn't really find a rhythm and score as much as she wanted to. But the third quarter, she scored 11 points out of the 21 points in that third quarter. And definitely, like, you know, got the Liberty going. What did you like from Brianna Stewart in the second half, in particular that third quarter?
I mean, she's a superstar, you know, so no matter what you tried to do to her in the first half, you know, slowing her down, she's going to keep driving. She's going to keep, you know, attempting to make her shots. She is a consummate player. So I think she was more aggressive. I definitely think she made Connecticut pay with the double team this time. She was well aware. I think getting it back out to Vandersloot, and they just moved the ball well. You know, I think all the players, there was total movement. You know, I think the first half, it was very static, just no movement at all. And this one, everyone was moving. And so it got someone open. Typically, it was Ionescu, but it got someone open. And so I think, you know, Connecticut had to pick their poison when it came to that third quarter. And unfortunately for them, it was Stewart still getting her points, but also Ionescu started to warm up, heat up in that quarter.
Yeah, and there was an interview that she made not too long ago to promote a new Puma shoes that really got my attention. She was asked about her wingspan and comparing it to players in the NBA. And I think, like, she had the same wingspan as Joel Embiid. She had a longer wingspan than Michael Jordan. And that really showed in the game on Saturday. The number of steals that she had, I think she broke her record with 6 steals, really disrupting you know, the flow of Connecticut's offense. That was the one thing that really impressed me. And we know that Sandy Brandello is all about defense, and that things will, you know, they will figure things out on offense as the season goes along. But that was really what impressed me, her activity on defense, the number of steals, or the blocks that she had as well when they were trying to get into the paint. That all started with that. And as you mentioned, one player that benefited from Stewie's you know, passing and creating space was definitely Sabrina Ionescu. So we've been at Liberty games for the past two seasons now, and we saw that teams started to double team Sabrina and put a lot of pressure on her in previous seasons to really disrupt the Liberty, and successfully, you know, at times. But now we have Courtney Vandersloot, Brianna Stewart, that can help Sabrina being that second guard and just focus on scoring basket. And she made them pay. Like, what did you make of Sabrina Ionescu's performance, especially in the second half?
Yeah, in the second half, she was great. She was fantastic. I think, yeah, her role this season will change a bit because, again, most people are going to go, I think most teams are going to go after Brianna Stewart because she can shoot three, she can get in the paint, she's aggressive. So they're going to have to pick their poison on who they're going to double, and the likelihood it's going to be Brianna Stewart. But you can't rule out with Sabrina Ionescu moving all over the court, she's going to get open. And she doesn't always have to shoot three. She's also good in the paint at times. But, you know, I think she made them pay. Some of those threes were way outside, and they were going down. So we have a great team, and we have a great team of shooters. I think in comparison to last year, you felt like it was all on Sabrina. And, you know, unfortunately, Laney was out for most of last season, so she didn't have that second person. She had Johannes, but again, it was really all on Sabrina last year. So, you know, this time around, she has a general, she has a superstar in Brianna Stewart, she has a general in Vandersloot, so she can relax a bit and she doesn't have to feel that pressure of carrying the team. Now you have, and not only those those people. You also have Jonquil Jones, and when she gets her legs under her, they're going to be a beast. They're definitely going to be the team to beat in this league.
Yeah, and there was a funny moment during the game. We had Mikal Bridges from the Brooklyn Nets that came to see for the second time the New York Liberty. And Sabrina tried to pay tribute to his three-point celebration. And I think she got a little mixed up. She pointed out 4 points and then realized that she did it wrong and then changed it to three.
Yeah, but she just got to practice. She just got to practice, Mikal. You know, I think, you know, she'll get it. If he keeps coming to games, then she'll get it down. She probably needs to have a chat with him, really practice what's going on there. But it was a funny moment. It was cool. You know, it'll take some time, or she'll figure out her own thing.
So. Or we could argue that maybe those baskets should count for 4 points. I mean, she said that, you know, it could be a four point play right here. But that would be for another topic of a conversation. Now let's talk about players that, you know, you might not see in the highlight reels, but I felt were really, really strong and brought a lot to the team. Betnijah Laney and Kayla Thornton. What can you say about either of those players?
I have to say, Thornton and Laney, they're the anchors of the team for sure. I think, you know, they definitely picked it up the second half. You know, Thornton came in after Jonquil Jones got into some foul trouble there, and they performed well. The stat sheet's not going to show everything. You need them for defense. Betnijah setting the screens, creating space, and just even getting her own steal and a bucket there. You know, I think they did great. And so you need them. You need them to be those disruptors on the other side of the court, which will create those turnovers. And then Stewie, Vandersloot, Ionescu, and even, I mean, Thornton and Laney are still a threat offensively. But, you know, you don't necessarily need them to be that offensive threat. You really need them to be the anchors on the defense. And they played with high intensity this game. So they did really well.
Yes. And Sandy Brondello in the postgame conference did mention Betnijah Laney and Kayla Thornton as the core of the defense. That it starts from them. And she thinks that they're going to have an important role on that team. And when you look at the stat sheets, Kayla Thornton was plus 19 while she was on the court. That is very impressive. And I think what really got my attention was when Breonna Stewart was asked about Kayla Thornton. And she said that when she found out that she was part of the deal and traded to the New York Liberty, she was really excited because she was like, well, you know, I'm glad she's on my team and she's not going to defend on me anymore. Which shows the respect that Breonna Stewart has for her and how crucial she's going to be for the New York Liberty. So I cannot wait to, you know, continue to see her bring that energy, that defense, that rebounding. I mean, she was at every rebound.
She was everywhere on the court. I mean, you know, she got some points in there too. She definitely had a few cuts to the basket. That was real great. I think, you know, she is going to be that defensive powerhouse they need on the court. And you can tell when Sandy was in the press conference how happy she was to talk about Kayla Thornton.
Definitely.
You know, having that plus 19, she was the highest for anyone in the plus minus on the team. So, you know, she is crucial. Her and Betnijah Laney are going to be crucial if they're going to make a run at a championship. You need them. And they're also threats offensively. I mean, don't sleep on these ladies. You know, even though they're going to be the anchors, they can get shots up too. So I'm really happy with how this team is looking. I know it's going to take time for them to completely gel, but just seeing what they did in the second half really impressed me.
Yeah, definitely. And the word is team. Sandy Brondello said that she's going to need everyone on the team. It's, you know, they need everybody to get where they want to be. And she did say that she tried, you know, in the training camp to try to get everybody involved and make them feel important. And there was one player that I was really, really excited to see play, and that's Nyara Sabally. From, you know, I've been following her since her Oregon days, with Sabrina Ionescu and her sister Satu Sabally. So I was really excited to see what she was gonna bring to the table. Obviously, she had a lot of injuries in her career, and she had a tough, you know, path to recovery. But I think one of the greatest thing while she was injured was the fact that she was able to be an assistant coach at Sacramento State. And she said recently in an interview that, you know, her being an assistant coach really helped her to analyze the game on a deeper level. And she also had time to watch the Liberty games last season and analyze their plays and see how they do things. So that's my take on Sabally before this game. But what did you make of her performance in her first WNBA game?
I mean, you can tell she was locked in from the moment she hit the court. And, you know, all the things that she did prior to coming to the Liberty officially, it paid off. I mean, that girl is explosive.
Mm-hmm, she is.
And she is quick. I wasn't prepared for that. And I was really, really impressed with how quick she was, especially on defense. You know, I think she was at the three-point line defending, and then she got right back to the paint within like a second. I was like, I don't even think I've seen that in most NBA players. So, you know, she is going to be another threat right behind Jonquil Jones. You know, she's going to have a good year, I think. She's really going to have a good year.
Yeah, definitely. It was a joy to see her on the court, and the way she was able to read the defense and cut to the basket, and you know, she had a couple of post move. That was great. I'm really looking forward to see her development and how things are gonna play out for her this season. All right, now let's talk about another bench player, Anshu. Saturday was Asian Heritage Month celebration for the New York Liberty. And as we entered the Barclays Center, they gave us a poster of Anshu. So she was the poster girl of the event. But obviously, we kind of feel conflicted with Anshu, not having a lot of playing time so far this season. And very interesting, at the end of the game, there was about, I think, 1 or 2 minutes left. The fans started chanting her names. We want Anshu. We want Anshu. What did you make of that? And what is her role this season? That obviously might be a little different compared to last season.
I love Anshu. I think she is obviously a crowd favorite. We were in the stands, and the chant, I mean,
it was loud.
You can hear it even when we watched the game back. You can hear it on the television, and I think, you know, she is just a player that, you know, she's still growing. You forget that she's only, what, 22 years old? She's still super young. So I love Anshu. I would love to see her out there more. But I understand that, you know, for Coach Prandello, that she has to get those starters to gel. Mm-hmm. She has to get that team locked in, and they have to be, you know, they have to be together. So, you know, for Anshu and others like Willoughby, they're going to probably sit the bench a lot more this season. You know, it was great for her to come in and get a bucket, and the crowd went hysterical.
It was loud.
But I also realized, you know, they were up by 15 points with it was like a minute and 20 left in the game. They were up by 15. Why not put her in? The only thing is, I realized too, is if this game was a lot tighter, if they were only up by 2 or 4 points or something like that, I don't know if we would have seen Anshu. Mm. I really don't think Brondello would have put her in, no matter how loud the chants got, because it's about winning this game. Every game counts. You cannot just throw a player in just because the crowd wants them, no matter how well-loved they are. She has a system. She has a plan. You got to respect it. You know, hopefully Han will get more playing time. You know, maybe they'll have some more games where they're up by a lot. But, you know, I think I just don't want Han to become a gimmick. You know, I don't want her to just come in because the crowd, and I don't think Sandy will give to the crowd every time. I think this was a one-time thing. You know, they were up by a lot. So, you know, but I love Han, and I think she should get more playing time, but I think, unfortunately, this season is going to be quite difficult.
I think last year nobody expected Anshu to progress the way she did. You know, her level last year was phenomenal. Her shooting was off the chart. So, and obviously, like you said, like, you know, very easy to root for her. She's, you know, so likable. So you can understand why the fans, you know, really like Anshu. But where's the progression is going to be for her this year? Obviously, she didn't get a lot of playing time so far this season. So her natural instinct was to take those three-point shots that didn't, you know, didn't get in the last game. But where else can she contribute? I know she mentioned that she wanted to have more block shots this season. Maybe try to work more in the paint. We saw that the basket she scored in this game was, you know, taking an offensive rebound and scoring on the inside. It's going to be those things like where I feel like, where can you contribute? Because, you know, the roster is so stacked that it's going to be hard for her to find a place. But I really hope that she can figure things out and that, you know, the assistant coaches and Brandello can help her to make that leap, because obviously everybody wants to wants her to succeed and everybody's rooting for her. So it's going to be interesting.
I know she's a good shooter. She's definitely a good three-point shooter, but she needs to be in the paint. She is taller than everybody else on that court. She needs to be in the paint. And I think, you know, obviously, you know, we don't know how much time she'll get on the court this season, but if anything, you got to get her in the paint. She cannot be, for me, I just felt like she does not need to be on the three-point line. Like, she needs to be in the paint and just dominate.
Yeah.
You are the tallest person on that court every time. Like, they can't touch you. And so I just think, you know, if they can play to those skills in the paint, she will be a huge help. But, you know, people like Jones, Sabally, their post moves are just strong and powerful. And I don't know if Han really has that yet. She can definitely get there, but her height alone, she just has that advantage. So I think, you know, it's not all about height, obviously, but if they can get her in the paint and feed her the ball in the paint, she'll be a powerhouse too.
Yeah, so overall, a great win against the Connecticut Sun team that was undefeated this season. And we know that was a very, very physical team. So definitely a great win that is going to boost the morale of the team. Now, next week is going to be a tight schedule. I think they're playing on Tuesday in Seattle. It's going to be the first game back for Brianna Stewart in Seattle. Then we're going to have another game where, you know, Courtney Vandersloot is going to face a former team, the Chicago Sky, on Friday. And then we'll go back home on Sunday against the Sky again. And maybe Marin Johannes,
yes,
will make a comeback to the team. We don't know yet, but it looks like it's coming soon.
She is going to be, whoo, I don't know. I'm ready for those passes, those lightning passes that some of those teammates weren't ready for last year. We'll see what happens this year, but, you know, she's definitely coming off a high with her team, Lyon in France. You know, they won their big championship out there. So, you know, I think she'll contribute. You just got another great offensive powerhouse in Marin Johannes. So I'm excited to see what she can bring as well. And also helping Vandersloot out, you know, when she needs a bit of rest, Johannes can come in and, you know, also play point. So it'll be good.
Yeah, we'll see. Well, thank you so much for listening to our podcast. We'll be back next week to cover the free games that would have taken place this week. So thank you for listening, and let's go Liberty.
Let's go Libs.